Good evening, everyone. I'm absolutely delighted and honored to be here in such great company. I'm humbled and, of course, delighted to be back here again. And I would not want to thank both my hosts and friends, Greg and Andrea, for always opening their hearts and doors to me, so I know I have a place to stay. I did expect better weather, though, because I left Toronto. It was minus 20 and snowing, and I thought, oh, I'm going to get some sun. And I think I talked about it too much, because it's been nothing but rain, and I believe when I leave, it'll also be raining. For those of you who've heard me speak before, I will repeat again that I'm a Pakistani by birth. I am a Canadian by choice, and Islam is my spiritual journey. The Pakistan I grew up in, and I've just returned from a visit, was very different from what we see today. It was diverse. The people were tolerant of other faith traditions which existed side by side. There were Christians, Zoroastrians, and Hindus. I did my schooling in a Catholic school and a Catholic college. And I read today that there was also a very small population of Jews living in largest city, Karachi. And they were mostly architects, and we have some architecture now that proves. And one of the cemeteries of the Pakistani Jewish community is actually protected by the Pakistani government. So it's something that many people are not aware of. There's a short documentary on that, and one day I'd like to show it to you. When I was growing up, there was not much information about Judaism or Israel, and whatever I learned about the Jewish people was from reading books from the local library. And yes, our local library had Leon Uris and the Diary of Anne Frank and other books, which are not there today. So I'm sort of trying to show you the contrast of what has happened since fundamentalism hit my land of birth. At that time, religion was not thrust down our throat, and there was a pluralistic ethos. However, today in Pakistan, there is blatant anti-Semitism and a very strong anti-Israel sentiment that is so political in nature. It is not based on moral considerations, but on ignorance. You know, Pakistan has a population of approximately 182 million, and it's growing. And so is the anti-Semitism. It was in the late 1970s, under the influence of one of our presidents called Zia-ul-Haq, that a strong wave of Islamist extremism blowing from the sands of Arabia engulfed Pakistan. And since there, this was also the time that my husband and I left Pakistan, because it wasn't something that we could cope with. Since there is a direct relation, correlation between Islamist extremism and anti-Semitism, the result was that even the man in the remote village who could not tell you where Israel was on the map, or who had never met a Palestinian or an Israeli, hated the Jews. He did not know who the Jews were, but he was being taught to hate. Hate being the most common factor on how anti-Semitism grows, when hate is taught at a young age, when it is taught in schools and curriculums. And this hate was being spouted from the pulpits of some mosques, and it was incorporated into the school curriculum. Even today, if you go into the rural areas and you ask a small child, what do you think about Israel or Jews, they will, you know, just show their hatred without any idea of who they are talking about. And more worrying were the conspiracy theories, which blamed everything from a rainstorm to a delayed flight on a Zionist conspiracy. And this, of course, still happens today. However, that was in Pakistan. Today, I'm shocked and horrified to see the rise in Muslim anti-Semitism taking place in educational institutions and governments in North America as well. In Toronto, where I live, I've witnessed directly what is known as the Al-Quds Day Parade, which is celebrated with gusto every year on the lawns of our legislature, but which is a hate fest. It is an absolute horrendous hate fest. Nothing but hate is spouted at this event. Of course, it takes place. Now, ironically, the participants of this hate fest are mostly of Pakistani origin. And one would want to ask them why they're not demonstrating against the human rights violations in their own country, against the persecution of Christians, against the persecution of minorities. But they come there in busloads, families, men, women, and children, wearing Palestinian headscarves, and they have been given these notes to speak about. And that is exactly what they do. So, right here, of course, in California, there is Imam Sheikh Amar Shaheen of the Islamic Center of Davis, who, rabid anti-Semitism. I mean, he did apologize to the Jewish community when there was a lot of media exposure. And this is what happens. The anti-Semitism is spouted, the hate is spouted, and it goes undetected for a long time because, it is being done in a language that people don't understand, or it is being sort of done quietly, and then all of a sudden, one person finds out, and it becomes, a media story. And then, of course, they say, "We're sorry, we didn't really know what we were saying," and they will apologize, but the harm is done. Because this congregation of young people who are going every Friday to that place of worship are hearing this over and over again. Now, it is not always based on hate, but look at the psychology behind it. If every week these children and these people are told that that you are better than everyone else, that they are not your friends, they can't be your friends, they, of course, meaning all of you, and if this is said over and over again, their values are not the same as yours. And this is done for Western society as well. Ironical, isn't it? They're living in a Western country, enjoying all the freedoms of a democracy, and yet they're spouting hate against the host community. Now, according to an article that I just read in the Detroit News, it says, and I quote, "The new face of anti-Semitism in America is increasingly black, liberal, and famous." And they're referring to people like Farah Khan, openly anti-Semitic, but he has many followers of his viewpoint. I mean, the fact that he can openly stand up in the public and spout anti-Semitism and get away with it without anyone stopping him is something that we have to think about. It is how people use our very freedoms against us. It is the rights and the freedoms that are being used to spout some of these anti-Semitic sentiments. When people in power spout anti-Semitism, it takes on a whole new agenda and a very subversive one. At that, your two newly appointed Muslim congresswomen, Rashida Tlaib and Ilhan Omar, they have very clearly put out on Twitter their hate against Israel and their anti-Semitism, and yet they are representing the Muslim community, they are representing Americans in the Congress. So, this is something that worries me a lot. Someone called me, a reporter asked me, "Aren't you proud as a Muslim woman that two Muslim women have been elected?" And I said, it has nothing to do with them being Muslim. It's about their ideology. It's about their policy. It's about who they are. What do they bring to the table? And what they are bringing, as far as I'm concerned, as a Muslim, as a Western Muslim, is not something to be proud of. So to my point, the rise of anti-Semitism is related to the rise of Islamist radicalization, and it's a well-funded, well-oiled propaganda machine. At this point, I want to make a little, point out a little difference between anti-Semitism and Islamophobia. A lot of people conflate the two, and this is happening a lot in Canada, where the Muslims are saying, and in fact we have a legal motion in our government called M103, which is a motion about Islamophobia. So the Muslims say, well, anti-Semitism and Islamophobia is the same, so let's come together to fight it. I personally don't agree. For those of you who may know, the term Islamophobia was coined after 9/11 to stop any criticism of Islam or Muslims. This is not to say that racism and bigotry and hatred against Muslims does not exist. But that's a different issue altogether. It has to be dealt with head on as racism and bigotry. The term Islamophobia for me is a loaded term. And when it is conflated with anti-Semitism, I as a Muslim have an issue with it. Because anti-Semitism has existed for far longer. It is institutionalized, it is a part of organized programs, it is not there to stop conversation about any criticism. So let's take a moment to explore the question of, are there Islamic roots of anti-Semitism. And, you know, I will humbly apologize to the scholar here who obviously knows more about this, but I'm coming to you from my perspective as a Muslim woman, as a mother, and as a grandmother. First of all, let me clarify the difference between religion and politics, because as you know, religion is not politics, and politics is not religion. When the two intertwine, we have Islamism, or political Islam, which is an ideology based on institutionalizing Islamic law or Sharia law in many places. And we call this Islamism, as opposed to Islam, which is a faith like Judaism and Christianity, and in fact has its roots in the two Abrahamic faiths. In my understanding, and in what I've read, you can't be a good Muslim unless you embrace Judaism and Christianity, which are referred to in the Quran as people of the book. So I will quote you a paragraph from a seminal document on Islam and Islamism, which was written by one of our board members at my organization, Muslim Facing Tomorrow. Dr. Salim Mansour is a professor at the University of Western Ontario, and he says, I quote, "The simple fact is that Islam and Islamism are not one and the same. Islamism is a totalitarian ideology, a perversion of Islam. Muslims are engaged in a historic struggle just as once Christians were in striving to reconcile revelation and reason in separating religion from politics." And he goes on to explain the difference between Islam as a faith and Islam as a political ideology. Now, many of you are familiar with Dr. Zuhdi Jasser. Just today, I was reading a quote. He is the founder of the Muslim Reform Movement. And I was reading a quote by him, and he was saying, in quote, "One of the easiest ways to spot an Islamist is that every other word they use is Islamophobia. As far as they're concerned, this conversation today here is Islamophobia as well." Now, Dr. Mansour also reflects on anti-Semitism, which is rife, as you know, in Europe. We have to look at what has happened in Europe, what is happening in Europe, and we need to take a lesson from that and ensure that that doesn't happen right here in North America. And he writes, and I quote, he calls it Eurabia. I mean, this has of course become a common term. "It has become an article of faith that Israelis have wronged the Palestinian Arabs and have proceeded systematically, in the words of Charles de Gaulle, to oppress, repress, and expropriate them. In supporting Arabs of Israeli occupied territories, Europeans can also assuage their guilt over the anti-Semitism of their past and rebalance their sense of political morality by embracing Arabs and Muslims as people of the third world to atone for their past sins of colonialism." Which brings me back to the point of anti-Semitism and Islam. The main point on Muslim and Arab anti-Semitism is that there is no basis whatsoever, or nor can there be, for Muslims to draw upon the Quran to stigmatize the Jews. The Quran, which is a holy book, as a revelation, cannot by definition contradict its own universal message of worship of one God, the God of Abraham, of Ishmael, of Isaac, of Jacob and Joseph, of Moses and David and Solomon, of Jesus. Indeed, the Quran affirms the history of the Jews as the original people of the book. And through the history of the Jews, Muhammad is instructed to teach the pagan Arabs to worship the God of Abraham. Furthermore, Muslims who pray five times a day bestow blessings on Abraham and his progeny, which is the Jews and the Christians. And I have read myself, because I had to prove that it is written in the Quran, that that land of Israel belongs to the Jewish people. So there is no contest there. But since Muslims can't draw upon the Quran to push their Judeophobia, they turn to the Hadith or the secondary commentary or the secondary literature on the Prophet's life through which to stain the universal message of the Quran. But you may know, and if you don't, I will tell you, that Hadith literature was largely fabricated to provide justifications to the Arab rulers who took power in the post-prophetic period, and it cannot be trusted to be objectively true. So you are going to ask me, and I'll ask that question on your behalf, what about those verses in the Quran that the Jews are admonished for their opposition to the Prophet? And they are there. There's no doubt about that. But these verses are of a particular nature. They don't have a universal content. There are two kinds of messages in the Quran, those that are universal, which speak of moral and ethical guidance, which speak of the commandments, which speak of leading a good life. And then there are those which are particular to that historical context of that time period. So those messages in the Quran are particular in nature, and they are not a part of the message of worshipping one God of Abraham. These verses are indicative of the opposition to the prophet, what he had to do in order to do his work. And this opposition came from many different people. It came from his own people, his own family. It did not end with him, as what followed after him was the terrible massacre of his family by Muslims, by the Arabs. So he faced opposition from many quarters, and this was an advice to him on how to deal with it. Moreover, the prophet was not the first of the prophets to face opposition, as all of prophets of the Bible have faced opposition, including opposition and betrayal, as Moses did when he came down from Mount Sinai after receiving the Ten Commandments. But Prophet Muhammad's relations with the Jews of Medina and his dealings with them belong to that special place in history. And that history cannot be appropriated by Muslims after him to justify their abuse of the Jews, as they have wrongfully done, since the larger and more important universal message of the Quran is repeated over and over again, that on the day of reckoning, none need have any fear of God, the merciful, who have done good deeds, including Jews, Christians, Sabians, and others. And this universal message overrides the particular instance, and we need to repeat it over and over again to young Muslim children who are coming to study in schools and in mosques, but unfortunately that is not the case. These lines are taken out of context and repeated by themselves without any historical context. So in modern times, Muslims have abused the Quran by using the Quran to justify their own miserable politics, whether it's the Arabs against Jews or the Muslim army of Pakistan waging a genocidal war against Muslims of East Pakistan, now Bangladesh, or the Muslim Arab army of Saddam Hussein massacring Kurdish and Shia Muslims. And there are innumerable examples, including ISIS, who quotes from the Quran, uses the Quran to justify their terrible acts. Now, the solution to the problem has to emanate from within the Muslim communities, where education of children must be tracked and monitored so that hate is not taught. And we do this to a great extent in our organization, especially those places where the language is not English, and we translate this. Today, there are Muslim women like my friend Soraya sitting here who are reforming the way Muslims look at theology, and they are looking at reforming the understanding of Muslims of our texts in a way that can be compatible with the 21st century. And this is why it's really important for us to have this ongoing, continuing dialogue, not only between Jews and Muslims, but between people of all faiths, so that we can understand the differences which are there, respect them, and then see what we have in common, and see that for us as Muslims, Islam is really Judaism-like. There is so much in Islam that has been taken from Judaism, and that is something that we must uphold and we must respect, instead of just taking things out of context. Thank you very much.